I'm going to introduce Glenn first, because I think he formed this band, is like the band leader, Glenn Matlock. Was that right, Glenn?
Yeah, I suppose I did really.
Okay.
I was the instigator of it all.
Okay.
But Rusty kind of talked me into it, really.
Yeah, but Rusty's so backwards in coming forwards, he'd never say that, would he? Hiya, Rusty Egan. You've only gone 3 months from the show. Your seat's still warm.
Oh, thank you.
And last but certainly not least, although he can't be with us in the studio today, is Midge Ewer.
Hooray! Hey, how you doing?
I'm okay. At home in Bath. Now, people have said, well, what's the common link between these three guys? Well, you were all in a band together, weren't you? Years ago, I think it was 1977. Midge?
Yes, I came down to London in 77 because Glenn asked me, which was really nice of him. So, it was 77, and I think, keep me right, guys, the album came out 78?
Yeah, 78. Yeah. So we sort of bridged 77, 78, maybe even early 79 as well.
Yeah.
Now, Glenn, you were in the Sex Pistols.
I was, yes.
You were like gods at the time, to the likes of me.
We weren't back then. It was getting that way.
Well, I had a poster of you on my chimney breast.
Well, perhaps she was an early worshiper.
How did you know Midge? How did you know about Midge?
Well, I'd heard of Midge before, because before we had Johnny Rotten in the band, Steve Jones was originally the singer. If you got a second, right? And he wasn't really the singer, right? And he was on the lookout for a singer. And Malcolm McLaren and Bernard Rhodes, who went on to manage The Clash, were up in Glasgow. And they was doing this, that and the other. And they bumped into Midge and got a phone number for him. And I actually called Midge from Malcolm's shop maybe a week or so later to see if he was interested. And he said, well, thanks for asking, but I'm going to do this thing. And it looks like it's going to do well. And the thing he was going to do was Slick.
Oh, right, yeah.
And they had some big hits.
Yeah.
And then I was in the Pistols, and it kind of went what happened with whatever the Pistols were me, right? And I started getting the Rich Kids together, and I tried out every person as a singer in London who looked the part but couldn't necessarily sing. And we was rehearsing one day, and we had some people coming down, and I finally heard the guy we was trying out as a singer properly, because the PA was the first time we'd had a decent one. I thought, no, this ain't going to work. And in frustration, I had to wander around the West End. I went in a record store, and I was flicking through the racks, and I saw a Slick cover. And they'd kind of been and gone a little bit by then, nothing against you, Midge, at all. And I thought, I wonder what he's doing. So we got our management to chase him up.
Wow.
And then he came down.
Midge, you could have been in the Sex Pistols.
I could have, but, you know, after the weird conversation with Malcolm, you know, he asked me, kind of, you know, was interested in being in this band, but he hadn't asked if I was a musician. So it didn't quite equate, you know.
Yeah, but Midge, wasn't it? Because you was one of the few people with short hair at the time.
I think it was. You know, I had kind of, you know, drain pipe trousers and a kind of James Dean haircut. And they stopped me because of how I looked, which is very bizarre. Yeah, it was great.
And that was when everybody, even the milkman and your bank manager, had slightly flared trousers and long hair.
Yeah, but it's because of you that I got a little thing going as a student, where all the guys who had long hair sent a part in Led Zeppelin album under their arm suddenly wanted spiky hair, and I used to cut it off for them.
Oh, really?
And they hadn't got any money like me, so they used to give me albums.
Fantastic.
So, yeah, yeah. Now, how did you team up with Man from Soho favouring the frilly cuff? You know, sort of, that's fair enough, isn't it, Rusty?
I was auditioning continuously for The Clash. So I was playing for like July, August, September, hanging out, going to Madame Louisa's, going to Roxy. I was on the scene, I was out every night, and I was telling people I was in The Clash. But they were going, no, you're not.
Yeah, so am I.
No, you talk too much. No. And basically, Glenn and Mick Jones were very close, and I think he did a trade. He said, if you put up with him talking and that, he's a good drummer.
Mm.
So Glenn gave me a shot.
Right. What did you, Midge, what did you make? Let's not forget Midge is here. What did you make of Rusty then?
Oh, I thought, no, listen, Rich Kids were great musicians, I have to say. You know, it was a really pleasant surprise. I came down for a night or two, I think, stayed in Glenn's mum's house, and we came down, and I did a rehearsal that afternoon, and we learned three songs, and you know, Steve New, who's sadly not with us anymore, you know, was 17 at the time, and he was fantastic. He was great, completely out there with his playing, but amazing, you know. So we learned these three songs. We went out that night, and again, keep me right, guys, because my memory's gone. We opened up for the Police in Islington somewhere, and and then we went to a warehouse party where, you know, I met the Clash, and Sid was there, and Susie and the Banshees were playing.
Oh, I'm
and,
really jealous.
And then we went somewhere else, and we opened. We went and played our three songs with the Boomtown Rats somewhere. It was just bizarre. It was a baptism by fire. So everything I'd read about and felt very distant from, all of a sudden I was right in the middle of it all, and it was just exciting to be there and be so kind of spontaneous, which I'd never been before. It was great.
So you come down to that London, and the streets really were paved with gold.
Well, no gold.
Tell you what, paved with gold. I don't know if you remember this, Midge, but when we did the thing for the Police, it was at the Hope and Anchor in Islington.
Yep.
And as we was going in, I was trying to blag us all in for nothing, and the bloke John sort of wound me up. And he said, "Oh no, you're not a band. I don't believe you." And as he was saying that, his assistant came up the thing. He said, "Our support band ain't turned up." And I said, "Well, we'll do it." And he went, "Well, you've got to pay to get in, right, and then we'll find out," winding me up. And he liked it so much, he gave us our money back and a fiver. So we had a pound each and a pound for our manager.
Blimey.
Who was helping us out, this guy, Alexander McDowell, who went on to become a big artistic designer in Hollywood, and he actually designed Charlie and the Chocolate Factory.
Wow.
Yeah.
That'd be about the same time I paid £1.50 the ticket price for the Police at Blackburn, St George's.
And guess what? That night, Henry Padovani was on guitar in the Police.
Yeah, so they was a four piece that night.
Right.
I don't think they was that impressed, though, with us, because Steve New broke all the strings on the guitar that they had to use.
Right, Midge, you're all. What persuaded you to get back together then, all of you?
Well, Glenn and I were at, you know, we did a gig 6 years ago. It was the first time we'd been together for a long, long time, and we did it to raise some money for Steve New, who really wasn't well at the time. And Glenn and I this year were at the Q Awards on the same table, and we're chatting away, and it's great and whatever. You know, I just said to him, if we ever did another Rich Kids gig, who would we get to replace Steve, you know? And it just started this conversation. It was just a kind of matter of fact thing that I popped out. And lo and behold, we started talking about it, and, you know, and decided it's very difficult to replace someone like Steve.
Yeah, is it going to be all right then? Because, so the Rich Kids back on tour together, but you did split up, I understand, over musical differences, because Rustier, he favours, you know, sort of electronic keyboard stuff and synthesisers, and of course you did, Midge, later, because you went off and did loads of stuff with Ultravox, but you, Glenn, were saying, "No, I want dirty guitar chords."
Yeah, but on the other hand, I've got an electronic toaster.
Yeah.
Well, that would have worked. That would have been good.
What Midge was about to say, really, about the music and what we were and the guitar player that would replace Steve, we were informed by the guitar player that you'll mention in a minute that we were the bridge between punk and new romantic, i.e. the Rich Kids were trying to look one way, not get spat on, not have the spiky hair, not be punky. Yeah. Glenn's idea of the rich was that we were rich in other ways other than in finance and money and prestige.
Right.
So we have now got a guitar player joining us for one night only.
Yes, and it's Gary Kemp's going to do it.
Oh, wow. Yeah. The Spandau connection again. Yeah. Oh, yeah, well, that's brilliant.
In Islington.
Yeah. Oh, where's the venue?
The Academy in Islington, where Spandau come from.
Yes, of course. I'm being gesticulated at now. I've got to rap. I could talk to you three all day. Midge, thanks for joining us.
Absolute pleasure.
And I hope you have I know you're going to have an absolute blast together. There'll be no shortage. There'll be none of those pregnant pauses hanging in the air where difficult moments where nobody can think of anything to say, will
right,
there?
We will be getting on. But I'd just like to say again, though, it's the 23rd of June in Islington Academy. It was going to be the 19th of May at Shepherd's Bush Empire, but there's a big problem with the roof, so we apologise to everybody, but we had to change
and the professionals are joining us too, with Paul Cook.
All right. right. That, what a night. Well, thank you for all coming on. Such a pleasure and an honour. And I hope you're all right by then.
Oh, I'll be fine. I'll be fine. Yeah. We're winking away at each other.
Yeah, slipped a disc or something.
Thanks for having us on.
He'll tell you later, Midge.
Okay.
Yes. Okay. Thanks, guys, for coming on. And here is Ghosts of Princes in Towers, Rich Kids.